Next, we discussed Danzig-Wolf decomposition for the LPs with block diagonal structure. LPs with block diagonal structure are probably the most common type of linear programs that are solved by this method in practice, and they have the following form. So first of all, we have k different sets of variables. So the first set of variables is given by the vector x1, then the second set by the vector x2, and so on. The last one is vector xk. So think about some very large scale organization where you have k different divisions, each of which manufactures different products. Then every division has a set of resource constraints, so the different divisions use different resources to produce the products. However, some of the resources are shared by the different divisions, and these resources are represented by these common constraints that involve all the variables. So these are our complicating constraints. So on the one hand, the company needs to decide how to distribute the common resources between the different divisions, which is represented by these complicating constraints right here. And then on the other hand, each division needs to allocate the resources that they have to manufacture their products in the most efficient way. So in this case, this block diagonal structure corresponds to our easy constraints. It is block diagonal because if we look at the non-zero entries in the matrix of the constraints, we see that it can be well described by these diagonal blocks of non-zero entries. So everything else would be zeros in this matrix. And these types of matrices, they're called block diagonal matrices. Let's denote by xi capital the set of the xi's such that bi times xi is less than or equal to bi and xi is greater than or equal to zero. So this set xi represents the ith of the blocks given in the easy set of constraints. And then we can replace all of these constraints with just the statement that xi belongs to xi capital for I between 1 and k, where xi is given by this set right here. So let's see what happens when we try to solve the problem with this block diagonal structure using Danzig-Wolf decomposition. To write down the Danzig-Wolf reformulation, we need to use the extreme points of the set x. And in our case, the set X is represented by the sets XI capitals, which are essentially independent of each other. So it makes sense to use the extreme points of these smaller sets XIs separately and represent a feasible point for this set XI capital as a convex combination of extreme points of xi combined with a linear combination of the extreme directions of xi. So let's see what we obtain in this case. Let's denote by xi1 through xiti the extreme points of the set xi capital. So see, we have ti extreme points for the set xi capital. And then similarly, we will have Li extreme directions for this set Xi capital, which we'll denote by Di1 through DiLi. Then by the representation theorem, if we look at the vector Xi that belongs to the set Xi capital, then we can write it as a convex combination of the extreme points plus the linear combination of extreme directions of the set Xi. As a part of this representation, we have the convexity constraints for lambdas, and then we have the non-negativity constraints for lambdas and mu's. Now, to obtain the Danzig-Wolf reformulation, we are going to plug in this expression here instead of Xi for each I between 1 and k. And we will obtain the following reformulation. So this is our complete master problem. In our master problem, we have double sums now, because for each block I between 1 and k, we are going to have these columns for lambda ij's, and the number of columns that we'll have from here for the block I is given by ti. And then similarly, for every block I between 1 and k, we will have Li columns corresponding to the extreme directions of the set Xi capital. So extreme directions for the set Xi capital are given by Dij's for j between 1 and Li. And the corresponding variables that we have in the master problem are given by the multipliers mu ij's. So in the constraints, we have a very similar situation. Again, we have double sums. Previously, we would just have a sum like this here, but now we need to address the fact that we have k blocks, and here we'll have the summation for I between 1 and k for the extreme points and the corresponding variables lambda ij's, as well as for the extreme directions of the set xi and the corresponding multipliers mu ij's. Finally, we have the convexity constraints for lambdas. So these convexity constraints are written for every I between 1 and k, and we have the non-negativity of lambda ij's and mu ij's. As before, to proceed with the iterations of Danzig-Wolf decomposition, we identify some columns that we include in the restricted master problem to begin with, and we solve the restricted master problem to optimality. Then we denote by y the optimal values of the dual variables corresponding to the complicating constraints, and by alpha I the optimal value of the dual variable corresponding to the ith convexity constraint. And recall that we have a convexity constraint for each block, so we have the total of k convexity constraints. So now we'll have k dual variables alpha i's, and again y and alpha i's actually represent the optimal values for the dual variables for the current restricted master problem. Once we have the dual optimal solution to the restricted master problem, we can formulate the column generating subproblem. And in this case, it actually collapses into k different column generating subproblems, because if you look at our variables, there are k groups of variables corresponding to the k different blocks, and we can formulate the column generating subproblem separately for each block. So the ith column generating subproblem will look like this. So we maximize y transpose ai minus ci transpose, all of this multiplied by xi plus alpha I over xi belonging to set xi capital. Let's denote this by zi hat. So this is the optimal objective value for the ith column generating subproblem. And then we need to pick the largest zi hat and the corresponding xi that yields the optimal solution to the column generating subproblem with the largest zi hat. And if that zi hat is going to be greater than zero, then we produce an entering column and we update our restricted master problem and we continue to the next iteration. Whereas if the largest zi hat is not greater than zero, then we conclude that the optimal solution to the restricted master problem provides the optimal solution to the whole master problem, and as a result, we can solve the original LP. So once again, we formulate the k column generating subproblems, one for each block. We solve these k subproblems to optimality, and if no subproblem produces an entering column, then the current solution to the restricted master problem is optimal for the original LP. Otherwise, we will have an entering column. We update the restricted master problem basis and we proceed to the next step. It should be noted that we don't really have to solve all the k column generating subproblems to optimality. Once we found a solution to a column generating subproblem for which zi hat is positive, we will have an entering column that we can use, and we don't need to solve the remaining subproblems. Alternatively, we could go ahead and solve all of the column generating subproblems and pick the one with the most positive zi hat in order to generate our column. So we can use different strategies here. Also, it is possible that we may obtain an unbounded solution for some of the column generating subproblems. In this case, we end up generating a column corresponding to the extreme direction produced by the solution of the corresponding column generating subproblem. However, if all the subproblems are bounded, then we can actually use the values of zi hats in order to obtain a lower bound on the optimal objective value of the original LP at every step. And this can be done similarly to how we discussed this for a single block case. So let's produce the bound based on the zi hat values. So zi hat is equal to the maximum of y transposed ai xi minus ci transposed xi plus alpha I for xi in the set xi capital. And from here we can easily see that this expression is going to be less than or equal to zi hat for any xi small in the set xi capital, right? Meaning that ci transposed times xi is going to be greater than or equal to y transposed ai xi plus alpha I minus zi hat. And this is for any xi in the set xi capital. Now, if we sum up all of these inequalities for I between 1 and k, we will obtain the summation for I between 1 and k of ci transpose times xi's is greater than or equal to the summation of y transpose times ai xi's plus alpha i's minus zi hat for I between 1 and k. And this is the same as y transposed times the summation for I between 1 and k of ai's xi's plus the summation for I between 1 and k of alpha i's, and then minus the summation of zi hats for I between 1 and k. So now, if we take xi's that will be feasible for our original LP, then this is our objective value, and xi's must satisfy the complicating constraint because it is feasible for the original problem. So this summation here is going to be equal to b. So this expression then is y transposed b plus summation of alpha i's minus the summation of zi hats. But this part in particular, y transposed b plus the summation of alpha i's for I between 1 and k, is just the optimal objective value for the dual of the restricted master problem. Because the objective of the dual restricted master problem is what? B transposed y plus the summation of alpha i's. And the optimal objective of the dual of the restricted master problem is nothing else but z bar, where z bar is the optimal objective value for the restricted master problem, right? So we have the duality theorem hold and the optimal solution value for the primal and dual matches. So this is nothing else but z bar. So we obtain the following bound on the objective for our problem. We have z, which is the objective value for our feasible solution, is greater than or equal to z bar minus the summation of zi hats for I between 1 and k. And this inequality must hold for every feasible solution for our original LP, meaning that it holds also for the optimal objective value given by z star. On the other hand, we know that any solution to the restricted master problem is also feasible for the overall master problem, which means that it provides an upper bound on the optimal objective value z star. So z star is going to be less than or equal to z hat. So now we have both lower and upper bounds on the optimal objective value for our LP, which come from the optimal solution to the restricted master problem given by z bar, and the optimal objective values for the column generating subproblems given by zi hats. So we just established this bound, which we can compute at every iteration of Danzig-Wolf decomposition for LPs with block diagonal structure.